During the Second World War, Allied aircraft conducting bombing missions over occupied Europe faced not only the threat of enemy fighters, but also navigated through skies illuminated by the bursts of Flugabwehrkanone or Flak, the German anti-aircraft defense cannons. Whether firing from ground-based positions, rooftops, or specially constructed flak towers, the flak served as the primary line of defense for many German cities during World War II. In an era before aircraft became too fast for conventional artillery and necessitated the use of missiles for interception, these cannons played a critical role in a city's aerial defense. Cannons such as the Flak 36 and 88mm Flak 41 had impressive firing capabilities, able to launch up to 25 rounds per minute. Most of these rounds were designed to detonate upon reaching a certain altitude. Upon explosion, the high explosives contained within would propel jagged metal fragments in a radial pattern around the projectile, posing a lethal threat to any aircraft within its vicinity. A fitting analogy for flak is a mid-air grenade. Fired into the sky, these rounds detonate upon reaching their target altitude, inflicting damage to aircraft through both the force of the explosion and the spread of shrapnel. Flak shells were commonly loaded with a blend of explosives and incendiary substances. Early in the war, two types of flak rounds were employed: impact and timed rounds. Impact rounds, as their name implies, detonated upon hitting their target. This was more commonly used for smaller caliber anti-aircraft guns, typically ranging from 20 to 40 millimeter, as timing them weren't necessarily practical, given the large volume of fire they could output for a given amount of time. On the other hand, timed fuse shells detonate only after a predetermined period, typically adjusted for a specific altitude, range, or both. Used in large caliber anti-aircraft artillery ranging from 75 to 120 millimeter in size, these weapons relied on the fragmentation produced by their shells. Due to the size of the weapons and the nature of the fragmentation, they were often utilized to unleash a barrage of shells within a specific sector or area to achieve their intended effect. While timed fuses were generally more effective due to the challenge of directly hitting aircraft, they lacked flexibility, often resulting in overshooting or undershooting their intended targets. Certainly, the timed nature of these shells meant they were susceptible to missing or failing to damage aircraft if the aircraft altered their course during flight. Later in the war, proximity fuses, which detonated when an aircraft passed within range, were introduced by the Allies, significantly enhancing the lethality of anti-aircraft fire. These fuses increased the likelihood of causing damage to aircraft, as they could detonate in close proximity to the target rather than relying on direct hits. In Germany, more than 30 different proximity fuse designs were developed or researched for anti-aircraft use, but none saw service. The high explosives contained in flak rounds produced distinctive plumes of black smoke when detonated, serving as a clear indicator to attacking Allied pilots that they were within range of ground-based guns. Spotting these ominous plumes allowed pilots to gauge the proximity of anti-aircraft fire before commencing their bombing runs. The guns were typically equipped with a sophisticated system, known as the Kommandogerät, an analog gunnery computer. Introduced from 1925 onwards, the Kommandogerät P-40 became the standard system for most of the war. This advanced system enabled remarkably accurate fire, accounting for factors such as the distance between guns and the aiming crew. It automatically corrected for any discrepancies, ensuring that all weapons were aligned precisely at the same point. As a result, a single command crew of 5 men could effectively aim multiple guns at the same target, eliminating the need for trained crews on each individual gun. Flak crews employed various methods to track and target incoming enemy aircraft. They utilized optical instruments, radar, and sound ranging equipment to ascertain the altitude, speed, and direction of the target. Flak guns were frequently positioned at specific angles to generate a pattern of bursts at the intended altitude. German ground radar systems were not sufficiently accurate for directing flak fire. Instead, during daylight operations, radar was used to align optical fire control systems with the target. Once the target was acquired, the flak was controlled optically to engage it. At night, radar was used to guide searchlight crews toward the target, with the remainder of the engagement conducted optically. Flak crews aimed to establish a flak box or a pattern of bursting shells in the path of enemy aircraft. The objective was to fill the airspace with shrapnel, creating a challenging environment for aircraft to navigate through without being hit. In efforts to enhance accuracy, flak crews employed a variety of tactics. They would anticipate the flight trajectory of enemy aircraft using observations, intelligence reports, and radar tracking. By strategically firing shells ahead of the anticipated position of the aircraft, they aimed to heighten the likelihood of achieving a hit. The Germans constructed massive reinforced concrete blockhouses, towering over 6 stories high, known as Hochbunker or High Bunkers, also referred to as Flak Towers. These structures were equipped with anti-aircraft artillery to defend against aerial attacks. The guns were arranged in groups of 4, each equipped with a predictor, a device used to estimate the aircraft's future position and provide guidance for aiming the shells. Additionally, searchlights were positioned in groups of 3, accompanied by sound locators. These locators precisely determined an aircraft's position by detecting the sound of its engines. The effective range of the sound locators was approximately 6,000 yards. However, due to the time delay for the sound to reach the instrument, the calculated position of the target could be up to a mile behind its actual location. Flak crews had to account for this discrepancy when aiming the guns. When flak batteries identified an aircraft, the guns were fired in salvos intended to burst within a 60-yard diameter sphere, aiming to ensnare the target. Typically, each gun, often 88mm in caliber, could propel a shell up to 20,000 feet and had the potential to incapacitate an aircraft within a 30-yard radius of the burst. Nonetheless, the shrapnel from the explosion retained the ability to cause significant damage up to 200 yards away. The German flak units underwent reinforcement by expanding the size of the 88mm light batteries from 4 guns to 8. To safeguard more critical targets, Großbatterien, comprising 2 or 3 enlarged single batteries were established, boasting up to 40 heavy flak guns. These batteries deployed rectangular patterns of shells known as box barrages, which proved highly lethal. Each battery, whether large or small, was governed by a single predictor, allowing up to 18 guns to engage a single bomber simultaneously. Additionally, firepower increased with the introduction of larger caliber guns, including a 105mm weapon and the formidable 125mm gun, the largest of all. By 1942, the Germans had deployed over 15,000 88mm flak guns, forming extensive flak belts that extended across routes leading into the Reich's industrial heartland. Stretching from the Netherlands through Belgium and western Germany, these belts were sometimes as thick as 20 kilometers. To evade flak fire from German ground defenses, Allied bomber crews often opted to fly their planes at higher altitudes before descending to attack their targets. However, this maneuver made them vulnerable targets for the enemy, who demonstrated exceptional proficiency in targeting and shooting down Allied bombers. As the war progressed, the danger of encountering flak increased significantly. To evade flak fire, U.S. bomber crews employed a technique involving frequent changes in heading. Flak rounds took approximately 20 seconds to reach the bomber's altitude, so altering the aircraft's direction every 15 seconds was used to deceive the Flak defenses. However, towards the end of the war, as the Germans were confined to a smaller area, the density of Flak became so intense that evasion became nearly impossible. The giant chemical plant located at Luna boasted the most formidable Flak defense in Europe. During a significant bombing raid on July 28, 1944, more than 600 B-17 bombers targeted Luna. Despite their altitude advantage, 7 of the bombers were shot down, and 217 sustained damage from the intense Flak barrage. Flak played a significant role in making flying bomber aircraft one of the most perilous and lethal jobs during World War II. It's also important to note that Flak defenses were primarily designed to compel bombers to release their payloads from higher altitudes, diminishing their accuracy. While shooting down or damaging aircraft was a bonus, the main objective was to disrupt bombing accuracy. Flak provided significant assistance to fighter pilots tasked with engaging incoming raids. In the U.S. 8th Air Force in 1943, crews were typically assigned 25 combat missions, yet the majority never completed more than their fifth mission due to the extreme hazards posed by Flak and enemy defenses. In 1944, Flak accounted for 3,500 American planes destroyed, 600 less than planes lost to enemy fighters in the same time period. German Flak continued to prove devastating during key bombing missions in the war. On the night of March 24, 1944, over Berlin, it accounted for 50 of the 72 RAF bombers lost. Similarly, during one of the B-17 raid on Merseburg in November 1944, an astonishing 56 bombers were either destroyed or crippled by Flak fire. The RAF Bomber Command calculated its death rate at 44%, with over 8,300 individuals wounded in action and an additional 9,800 taken as prisoners of war. Flak not only posed a physical threat, but also had a profound psychological impact on bomber crews. Flight surgeons observed a range of symptoms among these crews like insomnia, irritability, sudden temper flashes, blurred vision, weight loss, etc., all stemming from the stress and trauma experienced during missions over enemy targets.